This is the Earth from space.
Each time it's a little dot.
It's a little dot in the center of the circle. There's a story behind it. In the 1970s, these space voyaging probes were sent, Voyager 1, Voyager 2, Pioneer 10, and 11, sent to explore the planets in the outer solar system and then to sort of fling themselves off into the beyond the solar system. And I believe all four or three out of these four space probes, which were launched now, you know, many decades ago, are still operational. And they're now so far away that, you know, communication with them is very difficult. As one of the probes finally sort of, in the last bit of information we could squeeze out of it, this was back 10 or 20 years ago, the famous scientist Carl Sagan lobbied for and got permission for one of these space probes to turn its camera back and stop whatever science investigations it was doing and just take one last picture of the Earth as it was leaving the solar system. And by this time, it was basically reduced to a single pixel on the screen. And by itself, it doesn't, you know, there's not much to look at, but the symbolism of it was profound. And Carl Sagan spoke about the symbolism in such eloquent terms. I wanted to begin with that, because it gives, I think, some cosmic perspective to where we are. And I can't read it in the same beautiful way he did. You can go on the internet and find this just magisterial reading by Carl Sagan. From his book, Pale Blue Dots. He says, look again at that dot. That's here, that's home, that's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you've ever heard of, every human being who ever was lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering, thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines, every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization, every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species, lived there on a mote of dust, suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic drama. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings, how eager they are to kill one another, how fervent their hatreds. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors so that in glory and triumph they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. So there's more to it than that. I encourage you to go on the internet, you know, do a Google search on Pale Blue Dot and read the entirety of this beautiful description, which kind of puts in perspective how small we are. Of course, Carl Sagan goes to a different conclusion with all of this. I mean, his conclusion is that we're all that there is. There's nothing outside that pixel. There's nothing beyond that dot to save us. There's no God above. There are no angels, you know, in the heavenly realms to swoop down save us from our misunderstandings and our failures. And so therefore we need to rely upon our own ingenuity. However, it gives me a different sort of, what I come away with is a different sort of a picture, and that is to see this pixel of a dot of the Earth, you know, suspended in this immensity of space, and realizing that we are one among trillions of other pixels, you know, of other planets, just in our own galaxy, and that there are trillions of other galaxies in the universe. what is the likelihood that intelligence, consciousness, has only ever arisen once here on this pixel, here on this planet? It just boggles the mind to think that, you know, the infinite vastness of the universe is here only for us. It seems more likely, and I know Carl Sagan was a great proponent of this, and Baha'u'llah was as well, of the idea that life and consciousness is not a mere accident of evolution, but that it rather is the arrowhead of an invisible process. An invisible process that wherever it can, life will appear, and wherever it can, consciousness will appear. Somehow, in some way we have yet to understand. Perhaps science will understand more about it. At this point, it's still very much a mystery how life arises, how consciousness arises, what consciousness is. And it's possible that science will probe more deeply the mysteries of these things, intruding even into the terrain of what we might today consider the domain of religion or the domain of the spiritual. What we today consider to be spiritual realities, tomorrow they may be subsumed under a larger picture of the cosmos. But I believe, and this is a statement of belief rather than a statement of fact, that there is ultimately purpose to it all, and there is a direction to it all, and that direction on this tiny planet, as well as everywhere else in the universe, has something to do with the emergence of consciousness. And further, something to do with the emergence of self-consciousness, of creatures that are able to turn the searchlight of their intelligence inward and to realize that the depths of the inner consciousness are at least as vast as the vastness of space itself. The horizons of the universe are infinite, but so also are the inner horizons of the human mind and of the human spirit. Carl Sagan again, in the opening sentences of his TV series Cosmos, says, "We are a way for the cosmos to know itself." As religious a statement of the ultimate meaning of things as you can imagine, coming from the mouth of one who is not a believer in God, at least in the traditional sense. What does it mean for cosmos to know itself? What ultimately is the meaning of self-knowledge? Baha'u'llah, in one of his writings, quotes from an Islamic source, one of the hadith of Islam, stating that he who hath known himself hath known God. Somehow, the emerging consciousness of the human race, which ultimately turns inward and introspects and understands the depth of its own reality, somehow that is aligned with the recognition of God. Knowledge of self becomes equated with knowledge of God. Baha'u'llah puts this so beautifully in the Gleanings. He says, "Could ye apprehend with what wonders of my munificence and bounty I have willed to entrust your souls? Ye would of a truth rid yourself of attachment to all created things, and would gain a true knowledge of your own selves, a knowledge which is the same as the comprehension of mine own being. Ye would find yourselves independent of all else but me, and would perceive with your inner and outer eye, and as manifest as the revelation of my effulgent name, the seas of my loving kindness and bounty moving within you." So on this planet, at least, the consciousness that we have, the consciousness that this human species possesses, has evolved to be what it is in a particular way. It has emerged through, as we know, through through the science of evolutionary biology, from simple organisms to gradually more and more complex organisms, until at the tip of the primate branch, the human species emerges several hundred thousand years ago, more or less. That species, if we, the biological species of man, the idea of man, and the consciousness that we represent, one could say was there from the beginning, in the sense that there was an if there is an arrowhead to the evolutionary process, then like the fruit of a great tree, which is invisible in the stage of the seed, but is nevertheless there in the pattern of the seed. The fruit of this planet, which is human consciousness, was invisible at the beginning, not apparent in the stage of seed and in the early stages of the evolution of life on this planet. It only emerged fairly recently onto the world scene. But rather than interpret that as being, as human existence and consciousness somehow being an accident, if we see this as an organic process of emergence, then we can understand this miracle of consciousness in what I believe is its central perspective. But believing in the ultimate significance of consciousness and the centrality of consciousness as in the plan of the universe, it doesn't mean that one has to believe that there's anything inevitable about consciousness having arisen within this particular form. Primates with 5 fingers, 10 fingers, 10 toes. Perhaps in the millions or even billions of years that still lie before us on this planet, before our sun is exhausted of its nuclear fuel, other species will join us in attaining self-awareness. We don't know. One might argue that that the dolphins have awareness already of a certain kind, that an intelligence that we're unable to measure. All of this, the domain of science more than that of theology. But think about the phenomenon of consciousness and its emergence, not just a matter for extraterrestrial intelligence, but something which could be shared on this planet. There's no reason to believe that that might not be the case. But here we are, through this accident of history, if you'd like to call it that, consciousness happens to have evolved here among us primates. And what is one of the consequences of that? We take with us, and we bring with us, the baggage of the past. Just as we're characterized by this brilliant inner light, at the same time, that brilliant light has a dark counterpart. And that dark counterpart has to do with the evolutionary roots of human behavior. Joseph Campbell, famous for his discussion of the hero's journey, inspiring George Lucas in mapping out the plot for Star Wars, says the following in the opening paragraphs of his 4-volume magnum opus called The Masks of God, where he discusses human mythology throughout the ages. His starting point goes back into prehistory. He says, "The roots of civilization are deep. Our cities do not rest like stones upon the surface. Fathoming the grottos of the Cro-Magnon artist wizards of the great hunt, deeper still, the dens of the crouching cannibals of the glacial ages, lapping the brains of their neighbors, raw from cracked skulls. And still beyond, examining the enigmatic, chalky skeletal remains of what now would seem to have been chimpanzee-like hunter pygmies on the open plains of the early Transvaal, we shall be finding clues to the deepest secrets, not only of the high cultures of both the Orient and the Occident, but also of our own most inward expectations, spontaneous responses, and obsessive fears." one of those spontaneous responses and obsessive fears that we might say is still very much with us as a species, something hopefully we are destined to outgrow, but which is so much a factor in our daily life, in the political systems that we create and live within, and which is a vestige of this past primate existence, we could say is the idea of tribalism. The root of so much evil on the planet. Tribalism, the idea that lies within the racism, the sexism, the classism that so plague modern societies, have their roots in our evolutionary past, and we will continue to struggle to outgrow these in centuries and in the millennia that lie ahead. One of the great tribalisms that we have yet to outgrow, that we have yet even to consider to be a great evil or blight upon the planet, is the tribalism of nationalism. The idea that your fundamental identity as a person somehow is defined by where you happened to come out of your mother's womb on this planet. Why should that define who we are in such a fundamental sense? As long as we remain enthralled to these various tribalisms, we will never reach to the true efflorescence of that inner and understanding of that inner spiritual light that ultimately is the source of our ultimate oneness. We can talk about our oneness in genetic terms, in biological terms, but ultimately it's the fact that we all share in and we all partake in this inner light, which is that hidden fact that unites us all, and which the world needs to be more aware of.
Excuse me, are you saying tribalism evolved, like a survival tactic or something?
Yes, I'm suggesting that tribalism is an outgrowth of our primitive past. You know, the chimpanzees, the other primates, of the, you know, have innately a sense of tribe, you know, and that the social units, you know, within which they live and move are fundamentally defined by an idea of tribe. And if you're not a part of that tribe, yes, in part, tribes survive, different tribes survive through the principle of survival of the fittest. But the fact that we have this innate tendency to put other people in a category of either us or them is something which I suggest is deeply embedded in the human psyche. It's natural in a sense, which is not to excuse it, but it's to say that transcending this is going to be a generational process. It's not going to happen through in our lifetimes. It's not going to happen in the lifetimes of our children. But it's a process which the arc of history is bending towards the dissolution of these categories. That's what, as Baha'is, we believe. We believe that the direction of human civilization is moving inevitably towards a recognition of the oneness of the human race. This will require Herculean efforts to overcome the natural tendency of putting others in a separate category, dehumanizing them in so doing. So it being saying that this is part of our nature, it's part of our evolutionary past, again, is not to say, well, you know, that's okay, but it's to say this is a hard problem. And this problem is not going to go away anytime soon. But we can see where it's going. We can look at the overall march of civilization as the in terms of the expansion of consciousness in ever-increasing circles. We can, and where fewer and fewer people get othered. You know, in the beginning, civilization such as it was the tribal units of hunter-gatherer tribes in all struggling for existence in very small units. Just a few thousand years ago, a blink of the eye in geological time, in biological time, human beings started to come together in larger units. The first city-states in Mesopotamia, in Egypt, in this river valley, only go back, and in China, only go back a few thousand years, 5,000 years, 6,000, 7,000 years, perhaps 10,000 years, there's evidence of city dwellings in Turkey. But beyond that, there's no evidence that people came together in larger groupings. So and evolution has not had the time to catch up. Genetically, we are nearly identical today to what we were like 10,000 years ago, before there were even any cities. So just imagine how much inertia there is, how much genetic inertia there is to overcoming modes of social behavior which are innate to other primates, to our cousins, in which in many ways are also innate to our behavior, but which with the power of our consciousness and our ability to introspect and see where the arrowhead is going, we can work towards overcoming this. Yes.